It's a great joy to welcome you again to the Kanguka broadcast. My name is Chris Dikumana. Today is Thursday. This Thursday and next Thursday, I want to speak on the topic of being faithful in the little things. You need to be faithful in the little things you already have. Some people wrongly believe that they must first get rich in order to be faithful to God. They think that they must first get a lot of money, then they can support God's work and also help the poor and the orphans and the widows. If you think this way, if you think that you must first get rich in order to support God's work and to support the needy, then let me tell you that this isn't in line with what the Word of God says. Let's look at what the Word of God says in Luke chapter 16 verse 10. Jesus made a very important statement in this verse. He said, "He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much, and he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much." I want you to understand that this isn't apply only to money. It applies to anything that you've received from God. Many people look at the little they have and they think that it's not enough. So you say to yourself, when I get rich, I will bless God, I will support His work, I will help the poor, I will make a contribution to the kingdom of God once I get a lot of money. If you think this way, I want to show you that I am have a very different view on this. He wants you to do something for the kingdom of God out of the little that you already have. He wants you to use the little resources you have to demonstrate your commitment to Him. I really want you to listen carefully because this teaching will help a great number of people. Many people are complaining and they are in despair. They speak negative words because they don't have much. They don't have enough resources. Your salary or your business income doesn't allow you to make ends meet. You have many unpaid bills. You have many debts. Sometimes in the last days of the month, you and your family have nothing to eat because you have run out of money. I often teach on these financial topics on Thursday. Every listener should pray and ask God to give you wisdom and to teach you to be faithful in the little you have. If you're not faithful in the little you currently have, you will still not be faithful even when you receive much. If you can't bless God out of the little you have, then even if you receive much, you won't bless Him because you will keep desiring more and more. If you can't feed your family out of the small income you currently have, it means that you have to lower your standard of living so that it matches your current income. I have to repeat this. You need to learn to live within your current means. Don't try to have a lifestyle that you can't afford today. I've said this many times before and I will keep repeating it. Many listeners are living in debt because they live above their means. Let me tell you that I am speaking to you from experience. At some point in my life, I was trying to live above my means, and as a result, I fell deeply into debt. I struggled from one debt to another with no end in sight. Why? Because I wanted to be like everyone else. I had desires that I couldn't afford. So first of all, you need to live within your means. Then you need to give thanks to God for the little you already have. If you're able to give thanks to God for the little you have, I am we see the good disposition of your heart. So stop saying that you can't afford to support God's work and that you can't afford to help even one poor person because your income isn't enough for you and your family. You need to lower your standard of living according to your current income. Don't be deceived and say, "I can't live at this level because I have a degree." No, you need to accept your current situation and say, "There is a reason why I am has allowed me to live this way, and I want to demonstrate my love to Him out of the little that I have." I want every listener to know that if you accept to live within your means, you will have much peace. And if you demonstrate your love out of the little that you have, I am will see your heart and He will promote you in His perfect timing because you've been faithful in the little He gave you. I've already received many testimonies from listeners of Kanguka who have applied these principles and their lives were changed and they are now debt-free. You may have heard some of these testimonies in the broadcast. These are powerful principles from the Word of God. I will continue this topic next Thursday, God willing.
Now,
the second part of the broadcast, and we're going to continue our study of the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Today we're beginning the study of chapter 7. In verse 1, Paul says that we have promises. My dear brothers and sisters, I want you to understand the promise that Paul is talking about. Remember that even though this letter is divided into many chapters in our Bibles, it was written as a single letter by Paul. So here Paul is referring to the promises that are listed at the end of the previous chapter. You can see in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 18 that God made a promise. It's written, I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. So Paul is beginning chapter 7 by talking about that promise because it's a very important promise. I hope that you understand how important this is. You need to know that before Jesus came, it was inconceivable to call God Father. God was simply God. No one could call him Father, but you can now call him our Father, and we can be called his sons and daughters, and this is very important. Today, many people take this for granted, but it's very important. It's amazing to know that God is your parent. Your parents usually take care of you. They are patient with you. They forgive your mistakes every time you go before them. That's why it's amazing to know that God is your Father. So verse 1 says that since we have those promises, we must cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. This is very important. We need to perfect holiness in the fear of God. So what does it mean? It means that having the fear of God leads to the perfection of holiness. It's true that some people may say, I'm trying to walk in righteousness because I'm afraid. I don't want to sin. I don't want to steal. I don't want to commit sexual immorality. But why are you really afraid to do those things? Are you afraid of hell's fire? Are you afraid of punishment? Are you afraid of the consequences? Or it is because you truly fear God? Holiness, which is rooted in the fear of God, is what pleases I am. You stop doing those bad things because you fear God and you want to honor him. So you stop fornicating, you stop masturbating because you know that your body is the temple of God and you fear him. You know that you just can't do whatever you want with the house of God. Some people say, it's okay, I will commit those sins, but I will repent immediately after. Others say, I'm not going to do it because I'm scared of being punished. I fear God's wrath. No, you shouldn't be scared of God's wrath only. You should fear God himself. Your decision to not sin should be based on the fear of God. So that was Paul's message in this verse. He's saying that the fear of God leads to the perfection of holiness in us. I hope that you understand this because these are very important words. There is a lack of fear of God in the church today. I've taught on this subject in the past and I was explaining that it's very important to have the fear of God. In verse 5, Paul talks about the challenges they face when they came to Macedonia. They were facing many problems. As I mentioned earlier this week, the servants of God often go through many hardships. So Paul is talking about those issues to the Corinthians, not because he wants their pity, but so they can understand what they are going through and so that the church can pray for them. Sometimes the church doesn't pray for the servants of God or the pastor because they think that everything is fine with him. They look at him on the outside and everything looks good. He seems to be doing well. He's well dressed. Maybe he lives in a nice house, so they think that he has no problems at all. Sometimes I meet people who say to me, you are really blessed. You don't have any problems. Or they say, is it even possible for you to have a problem? They say these things because from what they can see, they think that all is well. One person even told me, you can't have any problems. You can't get tired. You can't get sick because we hear your broadcast every single day of the year. But let me tell you that there are many things in the background that you can't see. I do face many problems like everybody. It's impossible to serve God and not face problems because there are many evil spirits that are trying to prevent me from continuing to do God's work. That's why I keep asking you to pray for us. We need your prayers because they empower us. If people think that you don't have any problems, they don't pray for you. But if you know that someone is facing difficulties, then you pray for that person. person. That's why Paul is sharing about their struggles. In verse 5 and 6, he talks about the hardships they went through to the point that they needed someone to comfort them. So Paul is talking about this because he needs their prayer of support. I love what Paul said in verse 6. In verse 5, he mentioned that they were troubled on every side and their hearts were full of fear. But in verse 6, he said that God comforts the downcast, he comforts those who are discouraged, and he comforted them by sending Titus to them. I hope that you understand this. Titus came to comfort them. Our God is a God of comfort. I will continue to explain this topic tomorrow, God willing, because this is very important in the lives of the servants of God. We have a God who comforts us and who encourages us. Please read chapter 8 in preparation for tomorrow. May I am bless you. I wish you a great day. If you want to repent or you transformed by these teachings, you can contact us by sharing your testimony in order to edify other listeners by contacting us on +256 781 377 337.